You are listening to the Mobile Payments Today podcast, episode 2. Today's podcast is sponsored by Connect, the Mobile Customer Experience Summit. At Connect, you will learn the innovative ways top brands are using mobile and digital channels to increase profits and customer loyalty. The event takes place August 13th through the 15th in Chicago. Register today at mobilecxsummit.com.
Hey everyone, and welcome to episode 2 of the Mobile Payments Today podcast. I am your host and the editor of Mobile Payments Today, Will Hernandez. Well, we're off and running with this podcast, and I want to thank everyone who listened to last week's episode. We got a great response from it, and we're excited to see what comes next down the road here. We have another good interview this week, this one with Luann Alexander from Early Warning, which is the company behind Zelle. And Zelle right now is blowing up at the moment and brings some interesting questions with it that relate to a news item I'm going to get into right now. As I mentioned last week, the summer is a little bit slow. News isn't plentiful, but there is something that is going on in Washington, D.C. right now that's worth keeping an eye on going forward. And last week, we published a news brief from a Washington Post story about how D.C. council members have introduced a bill that would require establishments to accept cash payment for goods and services. Their concern in bringing up the bill is that limiting payment to bank cards discriminates against the 1 in 10 D.C. residents who are either un- or underbanked and thus cannot pay via plastic. And that's an argument we always hear when we're discussing this whole idea of a cashless society. What do you do about the financially underserved consumer? I have yet, personally, to hear a great answer from a payment executive about how they will address this issue. And with the success of platforms such as Zelle and Venmo for P2P payments, along with the adoption of mobile wallets, even though that's not as plentiful as people would want them to be at this point, the financially underserved consumer is still something the payments industry is going to have to address sooner rather than later. But there actually might be some pushback from consumers in general about the cashless society. A lot has been made about how certain fast casual chains are going cashless, and Shake Shack, which is something that I often, not often, but do visit every now and then, has actually received some pushback from consumers at one particular location here in New York City that was exclusively using self-order kiosks. While that development is about a couple of months old at this point, the Shake Shack pushback is something that comes up again and again in the cashless society debate. And it's something that's happening at other restaurants as well. If you remember a couple of years ago, Sweetgreen went cashless and they received some pushback as well. So it's going to be something that is a topic that we'll keep an eye on here on the podcast, and I'm sure it'll be the subject of an upcoming Q&A on the podcast. And on that note, stay tuned for my interview with Luann Alexander from Zelle, and then I'll come back with Suzanne Cluckey, the editor for ATM Marketplace. Be right back after this quick break.
At Connect, the Mobile Customer Experience Summit, you will learn how innovative retail and hospitality brands use mobile solutions to deliver extraordinary customer experiences. The event takes place August 13th through the 15th in Chicago. Register today at mobilecxsummit.com.
Welcome back to the Mobile Payments Today podcast, and I am here with my guest this week, Luann Alexander, and she is the Group President of Payments at Early Warning. And for those who are unaware, and I don't know how you are unaware at this point, but Early Warning is the company behind Zelle, which is the popular P2P service that is basically all the rage at the moment, and I'll get into that here in a few minutes. But first, Luann, welcome to the podcast, and thanks for joining me this week.
Will, thank you for having us. It's exciting to be able to talk about Zelle to this audience.
No, thank you. And this was something that I had on my radar as soon as we found out we were going to do a Mobile Payments Today podcast, and you were one of the first people that jumped to mind, so I'm glad that we're able to do this. And just as I mentioned here earlier, just the success of Zelle, and I think obviously the numbers speak for themselves right now. If you look at the first quarter of this year, $25 billion in transfers, and that was up 15% from the fourth quarter of 2017. And eMarketer, which does a lot of research in the field, predicts that Zelle is going to overtake Venmo later this year in terms of users. And I think the first question here is, what do you think has been one or two key reasons why this has worked out so well for the bank so far involved in Zelle?
You know, well, I've been in the payments business for quite some time, and one of the things that I've learned is it's very difficult to get consumers to change their payment habits. But we're really doing that with Zelle. We're really changing the way people move money. So I think consumers are finding more uses in their daily lives for Zelle. They have smartphones in their hands. They have instant access to their banking applications where Zelle is. There's no need to download another application. So it's that really that consistent user experience also across our financial institutions where consumers can teach one another, no matter where they bank, how to send and receive money with Zelle. So again, the numbers do speak for themselves. Our average dollar amount today is about $300. We have over 140 financial institutions signed up and 35 live. And then, of course, if your financial institution isn't live yet, you're able to download the Zelle app and participate.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing just in terms of the kind of the word of mouth and how people are finding it easy. And I mentioned this on Twitter not too long ago, but over the weekend, I met up with my sister. She had to pay me back for a gift for my mom. And she looks at me and she goes, "You do have Bank of America." And I'm like, "Yeah, I do." And she's transferred money through Bank of America before Zelle came out. She looks at me and she goes, "Well, I'll Zelle you the money." And I started laughing because, first of all, I don't have these payments conversations with my sister, of all people. But what do you think that says? How does that speak to just the marketing and the ease of use that people are so aware of this so quickly right now?
Yeah, so as you know, back in January, we had a very wide-reaching national TV marketing campaign. We featured David Diggs of Hamilton fame, who did spoken rhyme as part of the Zelle launch. And frankly, with those commercials, we had more than 3,000 ads through that first quarter, cable networks, print publications. We did takeovers in subway stations. We even had Godzilla in the middle of Times Square to get that awareness out. And it really worked for us. We had almost 8 million visits a month during our 5-month campaign. We were adding and still are adding over 100,000 consumer tokens a day to the network. So it really worked very well for us to get the awareness of Zelle out and for folks to start talking about it to one another as a better, faster, safer way to move money.
What does that say just about the marketing aspect of it? I spoke to Rose Carvo earlier this year about that for the site, and for our listeners, they can go on the site, look that up. And you're talking there about the use that kind of sparked afterwards. But also keep in mind, the banks have been doing their own marketing. We've seen it with Wells Fargo. We've seen it with Bank of America and their branches. How much is that helping as well to know that if somebody goes to a Wells Fargo ATM or a Bank of America ATM, they're seeing that advertising all over where they look? How important is that as well, that the banks are also doing their own thing with marketing?
Yeah, it's vitally important, right? The advertising that we've done with David and others is really to build the awareness so that when my bank says, "Hey, here's how you roll in Zelle," then we get that adoption. But it's that invitation from my trusted financial institution, you know, through that application that I'm already using, that really is driving consumer adoption of Zelle.
And I know during those commercials, one of the commercials had the fact that there was a thing with David saying that, "Hey, it's safe," or I think it was somebody he was talking to in the commercials, "Hey, it's safe because, you know, the banks are backing it." And I know Zelle really hasn't shied away from addressing some of the fraud issues, and I call them so-called fraud issues because it's kind of a fine line, I think, personally, when we call that stuff fraud. And it seems like the majority of those instances have stemmed from human error. But that hasn't stopped people from using the platform overall. And I guess my question to you is, can you help set the record straight here with Zelle security and whether in the future more can be done to kind of lessen the human error aspect of some of these fraud incidents that we're seeing right now?
So sure. In fact, this is something consumer safety and soundness of the network, their satisfaction is something that we take very seriously. And just so folks are aware, if your account is in some way accessed and somebody introduces unauthorized transactions, you're covered. Your bank covers you for that today in your use of online and mobile banking. So what I call that true fraud, unauthorized access, consumers should not worry about. Their bank has their back if that were to ever happen to them. But there have been some reported cases that are customer mistake, mistyping, for instance, miskeying a mobile number might misdirect a payment. So we are introducing additional features within the service that will verify that you're sending money to the person that you think that you're sending money to. So if I think I'm sending money to Will, but Zelle tells me I'm sending it to Nancy, I'll have the ability to very quickly cancel that transaction and re-enter it. And you've probably also seen, Will, some of the scams, and Zelle, just like any other payment method, is susceptible to individuals using that payment method to sell bogus tickets or sell things that they don't put in the mail. And we're really trying to educate consumers that is a vulnerability. They really have to know and trust the individual that they're sending money to, because these monies do move from one checking account to another, typically within minutes. So don't buy something from someone that you don't trust and pay them with Zelle. You really have to treat it like cash in that way.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned the whole thing about the problems that we've seen and some of the Craigslist scams and things like that, because I wrote that article, I think it's a couple of months now, just saying, you know what, sometimes at the end of the day, there needs to be some personal responsibility there on the side of the consumer to make sure they have the email right and the telephone number right before they send. Is that, Luann, is that a fair thing to say that? I mean, you want to say, obviously, hey, banks, we have your back, but maybe some personal responsibility in consumers just to make sure, just to double check everything before they hit the send button. Is that fair?
I think that's fair, Will. We certainly want consumers to make sure that they are transacting with individuals that they know and trust. And again, if you wouldn't hand them cash, probably not appropriate use of Zelle. But we do take responsibility to ensure that we know who is using the network. So the identification of those individuals that you're transacting with, that is Zelle and our bank's responsibility for doing that. And I'm glad to say there is no widespread fraud across the network. We are certainly focused on that. We have individuals who monitor it 7/24, every day of the week. And our fraud rates today are, at or below industry norms and what you might expect for a new P2P system. It's our top priority, as I've said, with us and our banks. We are introducing some additional features, like we talked before, to verify those phone numbers, to help consumers along with that. And if consumers do find themselves in a place where mistakes have been made, there is a way for them to dispute those transactions, and the bank will try to help to get those monies back. In fraud, again, consumers are protected. If it is a scam, then we will act very quickly to remove any bad actors from the net, that fraud or scams are not continued to be perpetrated.
Again, that's good to hear, and I'm glad to hear that, because I think it's been good that Zelle has been open about addressing that stuff and being upfront that, yeah, there might be some issues, like you mentioned, with a new payment method, and bad actors are always going to access these payment methods and try to take advantage of people. But again, it's good that Zelle is being upfront about it. Maybe one last question here for yourself. And I know you were at Money 2020 this in November, and I spoke to you at the Zelle had a little after party thing going on after, I think it was the first or second day. And you've been on the stage there, and I'm sure you've been around on the trade show circuit, as we all know right now. But what has that been like for yourself to be, I guess in some ways, you kind of been the face of this whole thing since the beginning. What has that been like for you?
Well, I feel very, very fortunate to be the face of Zelle, if that's what you call it. I'm representing hundreds of people within early warning, and thousands of people across our financial institutions who are very talented, very hardworking, and have all been very instrumental in getting Zelle out the door. So, I can't believe that we just celebrated Zelle's first birthday this month. I think everyone involved has really felt like we have exceeded the expectations for the first 12 months of the Zelle brand hitting the marketplace. And frankly, I think one of the things I enjoy the most is very similar to you sharing your story about you and your sister and your gift for your mother, is hearing those stories about how Zelle is really changing lives. I know my daughter's favorite transaction on Zelle is request money, not send money.
Sure, of course it is.
Some of us are going to be net senders, and some are going to be net receivers. But certainly, you know, through insurance claims that we see where consumers are out their car or have damage to their homes and are getting money put into their checking accounts immediately to help in those emergency situations, you know, to the American Red Cross using it also to emergency situations, or just, you know, kid at college who needs to get money fast. In fact, my daughter has called me in the checkout line needing to make a purchase that she didn't have the money for. I Zelled her the money and right into her account, and she was able to make the purchase without it getting denied. So, you know, that's faster payments, if you ask me. And I think personally, you know, I get a lot of a benefit from hearing those stories in the industry.
Well, I can tell you as a personal user, I'm using it more than I am the other guys. And it's been something. I think the ease of it, just being able to go into it within the Bank of America app, and I'm sure for others as well, whether it's Wells Fargo, Chase, or Citi, or whatnot. It's definitely been an easy thing, and it definitely makes lives easier, I think, just in terms of getting the money out there. So, again, it's been personally an amazing story, just the success of it in the first year and the use of it. And, Luann, thanks again for coming on the show this week, and I'm sure that we're going to chat somewhere down the road.
Well, thank you for having me. I look forward to our next discussion.
Welcome back to the Mobile Payments Today podcast. I am here now with our weekly editor segment, and this week I have on Suzanne Cluckey. She is the editor for ATM Marketplace. And Suzanne, thanks for coming on to the show this week. I appreciate it.
Sure. Well, it's good to be here. Thanks.
Yeah, no problem. Well, listen, we were talking beforehand, but talking a little bit about what NetWorld Media Group has coming up here with the new newsletter that we're going to launch, and you're going to be in charge of it. So tell us exactly what we're going to be looking at here in the next month.
So it's called World of Money, and it is going to launch sometime in July, in a couple weeks or so. Basically, it is just a really broad look at payments, financial services, anything to do with the business of money. So there will be some mobile payment stuff on it, some mobile wallets, some Bitcoin, blockchain, banking, looking for the biggest stories of the day. So it's going to be really a great kind of daily overview of what's going on in the world of money. And that's pretty much the idea behind it. It'll be a really quick read. The idea is that it's something that people can open up. They can skim the headlines. They can see what looks good to them. If there's some news that they want to follow up on, you know, that they might have missed, you know, if they want to read a commentary on a topic of the day, it'll be there too. So just a kind of a daily delivery of, you know, what's up.
And it sounds like you're not going to have any shortage of information, because it seems just in general every day we're reading something new that's happening in the industry. Is that kind of the feeling that you're having right now?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I was reading the other day that the American Banking Association is really peeved because Fed is allowing, they've kind of broadened the definition for credit unions so that they can broaden their audience, and that kind of cuts into the banking audience. So there's a controversy there. And of course, there's so much going on at the government level right now with Dodd-Frank, certain rollbacks of Dodd-Frank, stuff going on with the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. You know, it's just right now, everything is popping. And also just a tremendous amount going on with technology. You know, as you well know, mobile and mobile wallets, kind of there's just this amalgamation of things that are sort of coming together. And I think it's going to be really interesting to cover these things and see where the connections are from one segment of the industry to another, and just kind of, you know, keep that storyline going, so to speak.
Yeah, one of the more interesting things, and this is something that we've covered and talked about maybe ad nauseum for the past couple of years, but it's been this idea of the cardless ATM transaction that's kind of morphed over the past couple of years, where I can use a QR code to access an ATM. Now with the wallets, you can actually use your NFC phone, and there's an NFC reader on the ATM. And I have to say, as a Bank of America customer, I poo-pooed the idea in the beginning, but I find myself using it now. When I go to the gym, I don't have to bring my wallet. I can just access the ATM with my phone. And it's really been a very convenient technology. So what have you seen on your side of things when it comes to how this technology has evolved over the years to what we have right now?
Well, first of all, let me say I'm really jealous because my bank only got RDC last year, so it'll be a while before.
Wow. Okay.
So it's really kind of taking over, and I think it's because I think we've passed the tipping point with that, because we're seeing more and more FIs individually get into it. We're seeing some of the vendors, the ATM vendors, working with banks and working with also with processors. And we're also seeing it, and this, I think this is critical, we're also seeing it kind of lap over into the retail ATM world. That's a little, you know, more difficult because, you know, I don't know if you probably don't, you're just a baby, but back in the day, you could only use the ATM for your bank. And, you know, if that didn't happen to be convenient, then you were just too bad. You're out of luck. And then they found a way eventually to make it all interoperable. And by the mid-90s, that's what really gave the retail ATM its start, was the fact that they had interoperability. You know, with cardless cash, the interoperability is going to become really important because people don't always want to use just their bank's ATMs. And in addition to that, a lot of banks are striking co-branding deals with individual independent deployers like Cardtronics or PAI. So, you know, when that begins to happen, then people begin to get frustrated if they can't use this service that they really like with an ATM that happens to be convenient. So FIS and Cardtronics just got together to roll out cardless cash access at retail ATMs. So I think that cardless is, you know, it's funny, Will, because I think it's actually going to pick up faster possibly than mobile payments has.
That's a really interesting thought to dissect, because I think in the beginning, and we've seen this at our own shows, at the Bank Customer Experience Show, that what started off as like this small idea has gradually become more and more, it's gotten bigger over the years. And now, like you said, it's to a point where, not that it's ubiquitous, but it's getting there right now. Is that safe to say?
I think that we're on the way there. There's a long way to go yet. And again, you know, interoperability being one of the questions, but I think it's inevitable that eventually anybody will be able to walk up to an ATM with their phone and one way or another access cash through the ATM. As much as people say that cash is going away, there is really no indication that that's actually going to happen anytime soon. So people will continue to want cash. We're all just getting more and more attached to our mobiles. So, you know, it's going to happen.
Sure. Let's touch upon the cash thing for a little bit here, because this is something that continues to be discussed in terms of okay, what is really going on in terms of cash use and declining cash use and ATM use? And there was the study that just came out in the UK about how even though debit card transactions overtook cash, cash is still a strong second place over there. And I would imagine this trend is basically the same here and in other places. What do you kind of make of the whole discussion right now that's happening around the cashless trend?
Oh, it's a big discussion. We saw it with Shake Shack, and you did a great job with the blog that you wrote about Shake Shack and what they ran into when they tried to go cashless. Consumers do not like to be told how they must pay. They want to have choices. And the first thing that they do when you tell them they can't do something is object, even if they would never do it anyway. You know, the key to it is choice. I don't think cash is going to go away. A lot of people find it really convenient for budgeting for cash just because I never know when I'm going to be somewhere and I can't use my card. Or Sweden is kind of a good example of this. Their central bank is now worried because they've gotten so close or so they've gone so far down the road to cashlessness. The central bank is worried that all of the control over payments is going to rest within the commercial sector. And it is going to be vulnerable to attack. You know, electronic payments goes down, then you are really toast because commerce crawls to a stop. We kind of saw this happen a couple weeks ago when there was a major outage for one of the card networks. People were not able to pay bills. People were not able to go to the grocery store. And people were leaving carts of groceries just abandoned in the middle of Tesco stores in the UK. So this was a kind of a European thing, and it was intermittent various places around Europe, but a lot of the UK, some in Germany and other countries. So, you know, it was a good indication of how quickly things get chaotic when people can't pay. So, and cash is always that backstop.
Yeah, I think that whole thing that happened in Europe, and it was with Visa, how their system went down, that should be a warning to everyone to maybe put the brakes a little bit on a lot of the cashless talk going forward. So I'm sure that your publication, ATM Marketplace, as well as Mobile Payments Today, will continue to cover this issue going forward, especially into 2019. So, Suzanne, thanks for taking the time this week. I really appreciate it, and I look forward to our next chat.
All right. Well, thanks, Will. It's been good to be with you.
That's going to do it for episode number 2 of the Mobile Payments Today podcast. I want to thank Luann Alexander from Early Warning for coming onto the show this week. And I also want to thank Suzanne Cluckey, the editor of ATM Marketplace, for giving us a glimpse as to what we can expect from the World of Money newsletter. You can follow us on Twitter at MobilePayToday. Again, that is at MobilePayToday. And if you want to follow me on Twitter, I am at W_Hernandez16. Again, that is at W_Hernandez16. Thanks for joining us this week, and we will see you again soon.